Good morning. I'm Monica Mowdy, pastor of Carthage United Methodist Church. And yes, I'm here by the swimming pool. Because isn't that what we do in the summer? We hang out by the swimming pools, at the beach, on ball fields, somewhere in the sun. That's what summer's all about. And this summer at Carthage United Methodist Church, we're going to have some fun, some holy fun as we worship. Because the one thing you do when you're hanging out by the pool is you listen to songs. You listen to those sounds of summer. But what you might have missed is in those sounds, you hear God giving you a message. He can speak to you through any kind of music. So this summer, we're going to have our musicians at Carthage United Methodist Church sing some songs you may have heard on the radio, maybe even while you were laying around the pool or at the beach or at the ball field. And when you hear those songs, we're going to listen for the message from God. I hope you enjoy this sermon series. I hope you enjoy the fun we have with it. I hope you enjoy the music. And more importantly, I hope you enjoy the message from God. Let us pray. Almighty God, please bless us as we share in the sounds of summer. Let us hear your voice in the message and the song. Let us share in worship of you and sing your name in high holy praise. Lord, we love you and we praise you and we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who by his blood we are able to rejoice in your holy name. May the Holy Spirit join us and guide us during this time of worship. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Sway. My name is Joe Mowdy. Some of you know me as Papa Joe. I just want to welcome you to my favorite place to hang out. I'm going to be reading from Colossians 3, 1 through 5, 7, and 10. Since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, is revealed to the whole world, you will share in all his glory. So put to death the sinful, earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. You used to do these things when your life was still part of this world. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him.
I want to thank those of you that are passionate about giving to the ministries of Carthage United Methodist Church. And I also want to make sure that you know that the church has left the building. Ministry is happening throughout the community and beyond, even though we're not meeting in the church. If you are interested in giving to Carthage United Methodist Church, please note the ways that you can give listed right here on this screen. You can also call the office at any time or drop by on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. We want to thank you, and we thank you for your gifts towards the ministries of Carthage United Methodist Church. Hey, Carthage United Methodist Church family, I really miss you. I hope that you're doing well, and I would love more than anything to see your face in person. And on that note, I have an idea. We haven't had Communion Sunday for quite a while, and I would like to do that. I'd like to be able to see your face and wave at you and maybe throw you an air hug. So here's my idea. On Sunday, August 2nd at 7 o'clock, we'll meet on the back porch of the church. By 7, it shouldn't be so hot. It should be nice and cool. And we will have safe circles drawn that you can get in with your family or a homogeneous group. In other words, those people you normally hang around with anyway. Each circle will have their own loaf of bread, their own bottle of juice, their own cups. And we will have a communion service. And as I break bread, you will break bread. And as I pour the juice, you will pour the juice. And as I serve my family, you can serve your family. Also, that's the Sunday before our students and our teachers return back to school in whatever form it takes for them. So it would be a great time to lift them up in prayer, to lift our county up in prayer, our country up in prayer, and get this COVID-19 thing behind us. God is ready for us to gather in His name. I'm ready to share in the blood and body of Christ so that we as the body can be redeemed by that blood. So let's plan to gather August 2nd at 7 o'clock. If you know anyone that hasn't really been getting a lot of our technology through this time, make a point to reach out to them and offer to bring them or make sure they at least know about this. I can't wait to see you on Sunday, August 2nd at 7 o'clock. See you then.
saw the sun begin to dim, felt that winter wind that blows cold. A man learns who's there for him when the glitter fades and the walls won't hold. Cause from then the rub, what remains can only be what's true. If all was lost, it's more I've gained, cause it led me back to you. And from now on, these eyes will not be blinded by the light. From now on, let's wait until tomorrow starts tonight. Let this promise in me start like an anthem in my heart from now on. From now on. Drink champagne with kings and queens, the politicians praise my name. Those are someone else's dreams, the pitfalls of the man I became. For years and years I chased their cheers at the crazy speed of always needing more.
And from now on, what's waiting till tomorrow starts tonight. Let this promise in me start like an anthem in my heart. From now on, from now on.
Come back home, home again. From now on, these eyes will not be blinded by the light. From now on, what's waiting till tomorrow starts tonight.
It starts tonight.
Let this promise in me start like an anthem.
Scripture I'll be reading is Genesis 2, 4 through 9, 16 through 18, and 21 and 22. This is the account of the creation of heavens and the earth. When the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, neither wild plants nor grains were growing on the earth. For the Lord God had not yet sent rain to water the earth, and there were no people to cultivate the soil. Instead, springs came up from the ground and watered all the land. Then the Lord God formed the man from dust of the ground He breathed the breath of life into the man's nostril, and the man became a living person. Then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. There he placed the man he had made. The Lord God made all sorts of trees grow up from the ground, trees that were beautiful and that produced delicious fruit. In the middle of the garden, he placed the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But the Lord God warned him, "You may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper who is just right for him." So the Lord God caused the man to fall asleep. While the man slept, the Lord God took out one of the man's ribs and closed up the opening. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Dear hey, I saw you on the news today. Like a shock that takes my breath away. You fall like rain, cover us in drops of pain. I'm afraid that we just might drown. Dear hey, well, you sure are colorblind. Your kiss is the cruelest kind. You could poison any mind. Just look at mine. Don't know how this world keeps spinning round and round. You were there in the garden like a snake in grass. See you in the morning, staring through the looking glass. You whisper down through history and echo through these halls. But I hate to tell you, love's gonna conquer all.
You were smiling from that Selma bridge in Dallas when that bullet hit and Jackie cried. You pulled those towers from the sky. Even on our darkest night, the world keeps spinning round.
You were there in the garden, like a snake in the grass. I see you in the morning, staring through the looking glass. You whisper down through history and echo through these halls. But I hate to tell you, love. Just when I think you've given up, you were there in the garden when I ran from your voice. I hear you every morning in the chaos and the noise. You still whisper down through history and echo through these halls and tell me love. Thank you.
In the Bible, it almost appears as if there's two different creation stories. But what if they're not two different stories in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2? But they're two different points of view of what to look at the creation that God did in this beautiful world. In Genesis 1, we see this organized, chronological account of how God turned chaos into creation. And he brought order into crazy. But in Genesis 2, what we see is a different point of view by the writer that we think might be Moses. He wrote many years later from the stories that have been passed down. Is this point of view of God's relationship with mankind and how he created them. We see in this story that the world has water coming up from the ground through springs. There's no rain and there's a little vegetation and there's no one to take care of anything. So what we see is we see God scooping up part of the dust and forming a man and breathing life into this man and bringing him to life with his holy breath. And then he begins to put trees and plants and fruit and critters. And he realizes man is lonely. No matter how much he creates, man is not happy with what he has. He has no one to help him be a steward of this land. So God gives Adam meaning from the earth, a helper. He puts Adam to sleep and he takes part of his rib and he creates woman, Eve, which means life. And he brings her into the mix. And it started out that there were two trees in the middle of this beautiful garden, just like there's two trees here, a tree of life, a tree that gave eternal life, everlasting life, a beautiful life with God, and then another tree that was a tree of knowledge. But knowledge contained good and knowledge contained evil. It's much like this setting we're in today. Now, I'm not going to tell you where we are today. You get to comment that in the comments and we'll see if you're right next week. But I know many of you are waiting to hear where I was last week. But let me tell you, I was at Don and Phyllis Eccles in the back part of their land where I found that beautiful rock wall that was covered with moss. It was a great time to be there. So today we're going to explore this paradise that God gave us. This beautiful, gorgeous, wonderful garden that God gave us. And then us having to leave the garden and what that means for us in the world today. So join me on this journey. Now Adam and Eve started out pure and clean. No shame, no guilt. But that changed quickly. You see, God warned them that that tree of knowledge, that one tree that contained all the knowledge of good, but also all the knowledge of evil, was too much for their humanity to bear. That they could eat fruit from the tree of life, they could eat fruit from the trees that were growing all around, but they need not eat from the tree of knowledge. Because if you eat from the tree of knowledge, then you will have all the knowledge of good, but you would also have all the knowledge of evil. Now you see, God is the only one that is strong and powerful and almighty enough to withstand evil and not be swayed by it in any way. We humans are not able to do that. So it was not a good thing for them to eat from that tree. God told Adam, and then when Eve came along, God told them both. But you see, evil is great like that. It's sneaky, it's slippery. And the evil one convinced Eve and Adam that they wanted so much more than God had provided for them. That what he had given them was not enough, that they were still lacking in one thing. And that one thing was that knowledge, that tree of knowledge. And that if they ate from the tree of knowledge, that they would be just like God. And their broken, their weak humanity was swayed into believing that that power and that glory was so important that they were going to disobey God and eat that fruit. Now, one of the songs that Kurt and Jody sang, Dear Hate by Maren Morris, is an interesting song. You see, she wrote it, and then Vince Gill added some verses, and it's about, originally was about, right after the Las Vegas shooting at a concert where Maren had been totally broken by what she saw and what she felt. That was a little too close to home. This country music festival, this country music concert, and someone coming in and shooting a bunch of people, it was too much for her. And so she began to sing this song called Dear Hate, about how hate echoes through the ages. Vince Gill came along and he added some verses about 9/11 and Selma and JFK's shooting, and about how hate causes us humans to engage into activities that grieve God and cause us to make choices that are not holy and righteous in the sight of God. It's not in keeping with how we were created in His perfect and beautiful image. In the song, it says, "The hate that came out of the garden. You were there in the garden, like a snake in the grass. I see you in the morning, staring through the looking glass. You whisper down through history and echo through these halls." You see, God made this beautiful, beautiful garden, and He put two people in there, and He created them to be righteous and holy and perfect. But by eating that fruit, they could no longer remain clean and pure and righteous. Now, what we see in Scripture is that God moved them out of the garden. Now, He didn't do that to put them in time out or to put them in jail or to slap their hands and say, "Well, you don't get the good stuff now." You see, God knew that if they stayed in the garden and if they had eaten of that tree of life with that evil inside of them now, this knowledge of evil, that they would go on and they would live forever and ever and ever in evil. So instead, He set them outside of the garden where their lives would eventually end. But sadly, evil did not. Evil carried through the generations for years. We see so many times in Scripture where even Adam and Eve's own sons engaged in a jealousy war where one killed the other. But years later, we see humanity becoming so bent on being like God and being powerful that they built a tall tower, and then they became depraved. And so God had to make a covenant with Noah to wipe them off the face of the earth and start over. But it wasn't long before that righteous family fell into depravity. And then we see stories of Lot, and we see stories of Jacob, jealousy, pride, lust for power, greed, over and over and over playing out through the Old Testament, all because of that evil that was implanted into us, that hate, that anger, by eating of this knowledge that we can't bear. Okay. Now, as I said earlier, it wasn't a divine timeout. God wasn't trying to punish them, but He did have to set them out of the garden so that they wouldn't live forever with this evil and hate. But what we see when God realizes what they had done before He set them out of the garden, He came seeking them. He came searching for them. He called out to them. He made clothes for them to cover their nakedness, because now they understood that being naked was shameful and bad, things that they didn't even know before. And then He set them outside of the garden and protected the garden so that they could not come in and eat of the fruit that would give them everlasting life. Now, why did they do that? Why? Because sometimes within our humanity, deep in the depths, we find ourselves that we're not content with what God gives, that we want so much more. We want more and more, and we think that we should be allowed to just take what we need, take what we want, take what we can have. And the evil one there is there to tempt us of that very thing. And those choices that we make to not be content with what God gives causes us to take what we don't need and to pull us into a place outside of a paradise that God has given us. We are called to be in the image of God. We are called to be created in the image of God and to live into that image of righteousness, that image of holiness. But in order to do that, we have to quit living into what the evil one brings to the table. We have to be content with what God gives. We have to live into the paradise here in this world. It's here. We have to live into it. Now here's the good news. This great and wonderful God who loves and cares for us so much sent his son, Jesus Christ, to give us back our righteousness, to give us back our holiness. What he did was he had Jesus come and seek us out, just as he did Adam and Eve in the garden, to find us, to love us, to heal us into wholeness. He took away on the cross our shame and guilt from our past sin. He gave us a new life that is everlasting as if we ate the tree, fruit from the tree of life. He gave us an opportunity to live into this righteousness and this holiness. But here's all we are asked to do, to believe that Jesus did that, that our shame and guilt does not exist from our past sins, to believe that, to really believe that, and to believe that God will give us what we need, and to take only what God gives. And if we do that, we can be in paradise. Now, Kurt and Jody sang another song. It was called From Now On. Now, the funny thing about that story is it originally aired in The Greatest Showman, and Hugh Jackman sang it as part of that big, grand movie where P.T. Barnum is ready to turn his back on all the fame and all the riches and all the time with kings and drinking champagne. You hear those words in the song. Zac Brown sang it, and he wrote it, and he sang it to talk about how from now on, what matters to me is what God has brought to my table. In Christ, that righteousness we're given allows us to live in this perfect, holy love of God, shown through Jesus Christ and his sacrifice. And it's echoed in the final verse of the song, Dear Hate, where Maren says it perfectly. She says, Dear love, just when I think you have given up, you were there in the garden, like a snake in the grass. I see you in the morning looking through the looking glass. You whisper down through history and echo through these halls. But I hate to tell you, love's gonna conquer all. You see, she even wrote in the lyrics the word love with a capital L, because she knows that that love is God. And I want you to know that that love is God. The same God that sought out Adam and Eve in the garden is the same God that sent Jesus to seek you out and to give you righteousness and holiness with his love. Now there's a song that Jody and Kurt sang called From Now On by Zac Brown. Interesting thing, it was originally sung long before Zac Brown recorded it, in the movie The Greatest Showman about P.T. Barnum. And Hugh Jackman sang it. And he was singing about giving up on the kings and the queens and the drinking champagne and the fame and the fortune. And from now on, he was going to follow this different path. But when Zac wrote it, Zac also wrote it to mean this. He said, and from now on, these eyes will not be blinded by the lights. From now on, what's waited till tomorrow starts tonight. From now on, and we will come back home again. That song speaks of a desire to turn away from hate, to turn back towards holy love, to turn away from what the world gives and turn towards the perfect paradise that God gives. But we have to lay down this desire to need more, to want more than what God brings to the table. In essence, what we're saying when we do that is God isn't giving us what we need, that we know better what God should be giving us. And when it's put in that term, think none of us should be comfortable with saying we know more than God. I know I'm not. And while I know most of you watching this sermon are not people that are going to go out and take down Twin Towers or shoot a president or murder Martin Luther King or another activist, but when we strive to seek more than the paradise that God offers, we open the door to what the evil one offers, and none of that is good. I pray that today is the day that is your from now on, that you look for that love with the capital L, that you are ready to take only what God gives you, that you're ready to leave the world behind and embrace the paradise that is before you, that you turn your back on hate, that when you look in the looking glass, you see that love, that image of God, not the generational hate that has been passed down. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are our Father, our Creator, and you reign in this heavenly paradise, and we pray for that paradise to come in this world. We will follow your will in this world just as we would follow it in the garden if we could get back there. Lord, I thank you and I praise you for giving us daily bread and the bread of heaven. The bread of heaven that forgives us of our shame and our guilt. But Lord, give us the power and the courage through the Holy Spirit to forgive others of their shame and their guilt. Lord, I pray that we are not led into temptation by the evil one for pride and lust and glory and greed. And that you deliver us, you remove us from all evil, all hate, through your holy love. Lord, we love you and we praise you and we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns in our hearts as we believe that his sacrifice brought us redemption. For you are the kingdom, the King in the kingdom, and we love you forever. And it's in Christ's holy name we ask all these things. Amen.
Just when I thought